Good morning. Happy New Year. Did we cancel service today?
Once
we canceled service, then we uncanceled it, and then it snowed. So now I have to check. I don't think my camera's recording. No, it's recording. So, again, welcome and thanks for being here today. I missed everything else, and we'll keep it as simple as we can today. First of all, we're welcoming a new lay liturgist, my sister Jeanette Douglas, and I told her it would be a fairly light Sunday, not to worry about getting nervous about a large crowd, so you have succeeded in doing that today.
Thank you.
She says thank you. We do have a care card on the table here, that side. For Karen Olson, please take the opportunity to sign that. Also, we will strike the greens this coming Saturday at 9 a.m. So sign ups are over that same table there. So please sign up for that if you can be here. The 2021 annual meeting is currently scheduled for February 13th at the conclusion of the worship service. So if you have material due for the report booklet, get those into the office by Sunday, January 16th. And the rest of the items you can read on your own. And our prayer concerns, we've kept James Brink on our prayers, Ron Carter, Karen Cleave, still recuperating from surgery, Paul and Peter Deem, David and Rita Deutsch. Rita Deutsch is now free from her quarantine after having COVID, and today she is going to University of Chicago Medical Center to visit David. David is scheduled to have surgery tomorrow. It will be open heart surgery to place a heart pump in him. And he will be in the hospital for 3 weeks. And then after that, he'll be home on home health care for 3 months. So please pray for David because he's going to go crazy. So it's a tough time. And for Rita as well. And also then Tara Jean Brink-Jeckman, Shirley Curley, Tom Kerrigan, Deb Larson, Ryder Lumen, Carol Maddie, of course, Christy Nickerson, Karen Padilla, Nance Reekers, Sue Regal, Adam Salerno, Keith Sunder, Jim Towery, and Ann Washburn, of course, all of our military personnel. Are there other joys, concerns, or announcements to share with the body this morning? Okay, hearing none, we'll prepare our hearts to worship God by singing our song of preparation, which, if you remember, we have sung before, and it's, if you know it, sing out loud, please. Help me.
My path.
watched, knowing something wondrous would be happening.
We waited for the birth of Jesus. Now something wondrous is about to take root.
The darkness that invaded all lives was banished by the light of that star.
The darkness that surrounds us is gone.
Let us celebrate the bright shining of God's love in our lives.
Let us become those who will bring the light of God's love to others.
Please join me in the opening prayer. God of promise and mysterious light, be with us this day as we journey in our faith to meet your gift. Give us courage and hope along the way, as your light will continue to glow brightly in our path, leading us to service and discipleship with Jesus' name. Amen.
Let us now join together in singing our opening hymn, and with those who are able, please rise.
Mountain far and mountain following yon.
confession. Lord of living light, we hear the story of the Magi and tie it together with our own Christmas celebration. It feels comfortable to us. Break those bonds of comfort and help us to realize the risk of witness and discipleship for those who follow your light. Shine brightly in us and through us. Forgive the blindness we often offer to you. Give us vision of what you would have us be and do in the light of your love. Amen.
Light has come to you. Your light has come and it has raised the darkness. Now we can walk and work in the light. You are loved by God and called to God's service. Thanks be to God. Chapter of Isaiah. Darius, king of Persia, has permitted the people of Israel to return to Jerusalem. The prophet tells the people to arise, for joy, prosperity, and salvation are now in the city. God is with them. They will reflect the presence and the power of God.
Arise, shine, for the light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For darkness shall cover the earth, and thick darkness of peoples. But the Lord will arise upon you, and his glory will appear over you. Nations shall come to your light, and the king to the brightness of your dawn. Lift up your eyes and look around. They have gathered together. They come to you. Your sons shall come from far away, and your daughters shall be carried on their nurses' arms. Then you shall see and be radiant. Your heart shall thrill and rejoice, because the abundance of the sea shall be brought to you. The wealth of the nations shall come to you. A multitude of camels shall cover you, the young camels of Midian and Ephah. All those from Sheba shall come. They shall bring gold and frankincense and shall proclaim the praise of the Lord.
Our epistle lessons from Ephesians, the third chapter. It is part of God's plan that both Jews and Gentiles are called to share in Christ's saving activity. This is the mystery of Christ. Paul's insistence on Gentiles being full and equal members of the church has led to his imprisonment.
This is the reason that I, Paul, am a prisoner for Christ Jesus, for the sake of you Gentiles. For surely you have already heard of the commission of God's grace that was given me for you, and how the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I wrote above in a few words, a reading of which will enable you to perceive my understanding of the mystery of Christ. In former generations, this mystery was not made known to mankind, as it has been revealed in his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. That is, the Gentiles have become fellow heirs, members of the same body, and sharers of the promise of Christ Jesus through the gospel. Of this gospel, I have become a servant according to the gift of God's grace that was given me by the working of his power. Although I am very least of all the saints, this grace was given to me to bring to the Gentiles and news of the boundless riches of Christ, and to make everyone see what is the plan of the mystery hidden for ages in God, who created all things. So that though the church, the wisdom of God in its rich variety, might now be made known for the rulers and the authorities of the heavenly places. This was in accordance with the eternal purpose that he has carried out in Jesus Christ our Lord, in whom we have access to God in boldness and confidence through faith in him.
And our gospel lessons from the second chapter of Matthew. Wise men, in Latin, magi, were members of a Persian caste of astrologers and interpreters of dreams. Astrology was widely accepted then. A star was associated with each person. The way a star rose told the wise men that a king had been born. A later church tradition called the wise men kings.
In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, asking, "Where is the child who has been born king of the Jews? For we observe his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened and all of Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea. So for it is written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judea. For you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.' Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, 'Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so that I may go and pay him homage.' When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned of a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road."
Thank you, Jeanette. Before we have our morning prayer, I also forgot to announce that we did have the service for Linda Schmidt on Thursday, and the flowers that grace the altar here, her chancel, are from her service. So we want to remember Linda and her family at this time. Let us now meet the church in prayer. Eternal God, we thank you on this first Sunday of the year that you have never given up on us. Such as we are, you are still perfecting us. We thank you that even in spite of our tardiness in growing in grace, in Jesus you have embraced us in all of our sinfulness, and you gently lead us onward. We come before you today with some very specific requests. Grow our hearts more generous, in order that we might forgive those to whom we are so little inclined to want to extend mercy. Help us to release those resentments which we so consistently nurture and tightly embrace. Temper the watchful eye attitude within us which sees so glaringly the offenses and mistakes of our sisters and brothers. Without diminishing our passion for righteousness, give us gentle and gracious spirits which make room for, rather than alienation from, those who wrong and sin against us. Be also with the world of nations. We are reminded by the behavior of Herod how tenuous is the thread by which power is held, and how the thread of power lost causes people to do what normally would be unthinkable. Be in all those places where people seek, like the Magi, to journey to find Jesus, Child of Hope. Be with all who follow the bright stars of their lives and wish freedom and peace. Be with all who live with the threats of reprisal, persecution, or danger because of their beliefs. Be with all leaders and temper their power with justice and love for people. Oh God, may the tragedies of the past not be repeated. May there be peace and goodwill among all people, and may their journeys through life not be interrupted by tyrants. All this we pray in the name of our Savior, who taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
We do both the first and the second hymns this morning because it covers the whole Christmas story and it also ties into Epiphany. And I'm usually gone the first Sunday in January, so I don't have to sing these things. But they're very long, but they're very encompassing. So we're taking a time out while I just finish pouring myself some water before I start the message, and then we'll be on our way. Good news, the last hymn we're singing only has four verses. I want you to think about, whoop, let's turn myself off. There we go. I want you to think about the last trip you took to a new place. Maybe you went on a vacation, or maybe you just went across town. Did you notice that it seemed to take more time to reach your destination than it did to return home? This sensation of seeming to take longer to make a trip than it is to return home is universal and even has an official scientific name. It's referred to as the return trip effect by those who research it. There are plenty of theories behind what causes the return trip effect. Researchers believe three things: emotions, expectations, and familiarity affect our perception of how time passes. Strong emotions like fear or excitement seem to slow down our perception of time. Any parent who has heard the question, "Are we there yet?" from the backseat of the car can relate to the sensation that time has slowed down to a crawl. The more excited you are about your ultimate destination, the longer the trip seems to take. I wonder if the Magi, the wise men in our Bible passage, felt like time dragged on as they traveled to see the new king of the Jews. Think of all the emotions they experienced: excitement, wonder, fear. They were astrologers who studied the stars and ancient prophecy. They knew that a brilliant star would one day mark the birthplace of the new king of the Jews. So when that long-awaited star appeared in the sky, they set out for Bethlehem full of excitement and anticipation. Time probably moved at a snail's pace. And then, they met Herod. Welcome to this celebration of the Epiphany of our Lord. Actually, it takes place on January 6th, the day when we celebrate the Magi, or wise men, who came from the east to worship the baby Jesus. Epiphany marks the moment when Jesus was recognized as the Messiah sent for all people, because the Magi were the first non-Jewish people to bow down and worship him as king. When we read the story of the Magi, we usually focus on the Instagram-worthy aspects of it: the brilliant star hanging up there over the stable, the precious baby Jesus in the manger, the wise men dressed in fine robes and bringing magnificent gifts. Sounds like a nice children's play, but it doesn't sound like real life until we get to King Herod. Herod was a real pain. The Roman government appointed Herod to rule over the region of Judea. Pastor Aaron Christie used graphic terms to describe Herod's political methods. He said that Herod used one of two methods to respond to his enemies. He either bought them or he butchered them. And that's an apt description of Herod's methods. To appease the Jewish religious leaders, Herod built a magnificent new temple. It was an effective way to buy off his opponents. But when the wealthy and prominent citizens of Palestine opposed his rule, he slaughtered 45 of the ruling families. Pastor Christie provides this stunning example of Herod's approach to ruling Judea. He said, when it came to his chief opponent, Aristobulus, Herod invited him to a swimming party in the Jordan River, bribed his bodyguards, and had him drowned. And then he turned around and threw him a magnificent funeral. And those are just a few of the people that Herod murdered so he could hold on to power. Think about that as you listen to these words again from our Bible passage this morning. Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me so that I too may go and worship him." Every November, a small village in England hosts the world's biggest liar competition. The folks in Sandon Bridge hold the world's biggest liar contest in honor of a local citizen Will Ritson, who was famous for his tall tales. Ritson died in 1890, but his reputation for telling colorful lies inspired the townsfolk to create this competition. According to official rules, the competition is open to everyone except lawyers and politicians, because they are judged to be too skilled at telling porkies, the British slang for lies. King Herod, the ultimate stereotype of a ruthless politician, wouldn't have been eligible to compete for the title of the world's biggest liar because he had too much practice at it. And the Magi, the wise men, surely knew that a man as ruthless and power-hungry as Herod would never bow down to another king. This left them with a dangerous choice. Which king would they honor? They had come to Bethlehem to worship the king of peace, Jesus. But then they were confronted by the king of power, Herod. Go along with Herod and betray Jesus, or worship Jesus and earn yourself a ruthless enemy. If you were in their shoes, what would you do? The message of Epiphany is that every person must eventually choose which king to honor, the king of power or the king of peace. A couple of years ago, a former executive with a major health insurance company made a public confession of how he had been paid for years by insurance companies to spread disinformation about the Canadian healthcare system. He was paid to portray it as inferior in the care it gave. And he had no problem lying on behalf of the employer. Until the day he visited his father, who lived in a rural part of East Tennessee. A local nonprofit was advertising a free health clinic for local families. The executive drove out to the event, and what he saw was appalling. He saw long lines of people waiting in the rain for hours who were desperate to see a doctor or a nurse. He met families who had lined up early and slept in their cars for two or three nights for this event. He says that as he left the event that day, he realized that in many areas of our country, our healthcare system is broken. And he realized that his misinformation helped to keep it that way. So he left his high-paying, comfortable job with one of the most powerful insurance companies in the nation. He wrote a book about the lies he told in support of his former employer. And out in that field in East Tennessee, this executive realized that he had to make a choice. Would he continue spreading lies that had supported a powerful corporation? Or would he lose his job and reputation in order to tell the truth? The Epiphany story reminds us that Jesus stands against the kingdoms of this world. From the moment Jesus was born, he was on the wrong side of society's power structures. And if you read through the New Testament, he remained on the wrong side of the political and social and religious power structure his whole life. Why? Because Jesus came to bring us something so much more valuable: love, justice, and righteousness for all people. Reverend Jim Wallace tells of participating in a worship service at a South African church during the days of apartheid. In those days, the government of South Africa officially sanctioned discrimination against and oppression of black South African citizens. Nelson Mandela, a political leader and Christian, had spent decades in prison for advocating the end of apartheid. Recently deceased South African Bishop Desmond Tutu planned to hold a political rally at St. George's Cathedral in Cape Town, South Africa, but it had to be called off. So Bishop Tutu held a worship service instead. Hundreds of South African police officers gathered outside the cathedral to intimidate the worshipers. And then the officers began coming inside, lining the walls of the church and taping the service. Pastor Wallace reports being afraid for his life. But if Bishop Tutu was afraid, he didn't show it. He stood up and announced, "This system of apartheid cannot endure because it is evil." He pointed at the officer standing along the walls and said, "You are powerful. You are very powerful, but you are not gods. And I serve a God who cannot be mocked. So since you've already lost, I invite you today to come and join the winning side." And the congregation leapt to their feet in joy. They began dancing for joy at Bishop Tutu's words And the surprised officers left the church because they didn't know what to do with this incredible expression of joy. The Herods of this world will never understand the courage and hope and joy that come from choosing the King of Peace. What about us? How do we know which king we've chosen to honor? The Epiphany story tells us that you know which king you've chosen by what it costs you to follow him. What did the wise men choose? After they visited the baby Jesus and worshiped him, they were warned in a dream not to return to Herod. So they chose to go home by another way. And what did this decision cost them? Probably the making of a very powerful enemy. I wonder if they ever stopped or stepped foot in Judea again while Herod was alive. But once they met Jesus, the King of Peace, they were willing to risk offending a ruthless monarch. Instead of the King of Power, they had met a king who gave up all his power to come in the form of a helpless baby. All they knew that a king who could love humanity that much was worth any sacrifice. Jesus could have come as a conquering king who raised an army and defeated every kingdom on earth. But instead, he came as a helpless baby, born to a poor couple. He could have cozied up to the religious leaders of his day and been the most popular teacher in the temple. Instead, he hung out with sinners and tax collectors and stayed in constant trouble with the religious elites. He could have called down a host of angels to eliminate every Herod in his path. Instead, he chose to die a desperately painful and humiliating death to save everyone, even those who hated him, from the power of death. You know, in our culture, there's a big difference between being a Christian and being Christ-like. It's so easy to be a Christian in our culture. We have access to an abundance of Christian radio stations, TV stations, websites, magazines, streaming movie services, and books. There are Christian business directories for almost every community in the U.S. And in most communities, there's a Christian church practically on every street corner. Everywhere you look, you can see some evidence of Christianity in our culture. But can you see evidence of Christ's? Do you see the hungry being fed and clothed, the homeless being housed, the stranger being welcomed like a friend, the sick and imprisoned being comforted? Do you see the people of God doing justice, loving mercy, and walking humbly with their God? Do you see Jesus' followers choosing the kingdom of power or the kingdom of peace? Pastor John Pavelko tells a story about a woman named Carolyn Cooper who faced a tough choice about protecting her own lifestyle or making sacrifices for her faith. On a mission trip to the Dominican Republic, Carolyn encountered an 8-month-old baby named Lusitania, who was dying from malnutrition. By the time Lusitania's poor parents got her to a doctor, she was beyond saving. She died not long after Carolyn returned home. In honor of this precious child, Carolyn began sponsoring 3 little girls in another country. She spent around $100 a month to provide them with food, clothing, and spiritual outreach services. To a widow with 5 grown children, $100 a month is a huge financial commitment. But it brought Carolyn joy, so she was happy to make the sacrifice. Around Christmas of that year, Carolyn received notice that she was going to be laid off from her job. Now, most of us would have cut way back on our charitable giving at this point, so we could look out for our own needs, but not Carolyn Cooper. She cut her budget to the bone so she could continue to sponsor her overseas children. And members of her church who were aware of her sacrifice also sent donations to help. Carolyn keeps a photo on her fridge of her holding the baby Lusitania, the child who died of hunger, to remind her of why she makes this sacrifice. So what about you? When your choice to follow Jesus conflicts with your comfort, your status, your success, your security, which will you choose? You'll never know which kingdom is your priority unless the decision costs you, unless it separates you from the kingdoms of this world. And that's a scary place to be. But it's exactly the place, the choice that Jesus made, and he calls us to make it as well. Amen.
table. You gave us the gift of a Savior, sent for the rich and the poor alike. Every gift given from the heart is blessed by you, and every act that proclaims your love brings joy to you. May the gifts that we offer and the love we proclaim to others in our words and in actions satisfy your heart this day and all through the coming years. We pray this in Christ's holy name. Amen.
God's world, bearing the light of hope and peace. Bring the good news of the love of God through Jesus Christ to all people. And most of all, go in peace.